We have a lot of learning to do. We as a congregation, we as a community, we as a nation. Some of these gaps in our learning are honing in right now, right through the middle of the work we do and the town we live in. The Bible texts have some insight which can apply to what we have to deal with, and we have other sources to consult and ponder as well. I want to start with the intersection of two problems that we need to address as a community. They are racial harassment in our schools and racial harassment of a member of our community that spoke up to defend her child, a mixed-race kid that was harassed to the point where he had to be taken out of the Chaska school district. I need to do a brief recap of the events, and I hope I get it right. There's far more here than I can adequately summarize. But I want to go back a little further. You may remember a couple years ago, a young teen came to me and talked about the bullying she was getting, primarily because she was defending other kids from being bullied. This is a white girl, about 17. Because she's defending other kids, she was in turn sexually bullied, harassed, and abused, sometimes in a classroom with a teacher present. She got no support at all from the teacher. At almost the same time, a 12-year-old girl named Iris committed suicide, and we did a candlelight service for her at the request of her friends. We don't know why, and the family would not talk about it, but the impression everyone had was that it was caused by bullying. She was a white girl. We did a Tuesday dialogue where the teen woman who defended the other kids spoke to her experience. A member of the school district came to speak to what was being said and told us that school assemblies don't work because kids don't listen and they don't behave. To me, this sounded just lazy. What that means is that they think the kids are too stupid to take it seriously. Then afterwards, he said with a wry smile on his face, "Well, you can't believe everything the kids tell you." Which indicated to me that the school's policy was not to believe anything the kids told you. Now we have several accounts, many instances of public racism and one-to-one harassment. Blackface kids, racist postings, physical abuse. Black History Month was totally mishandled, where Malcolm X was considered not historical, which is astonishing coming from an educator. The major confrontations escalated at the school board meeting, where a 20-minute public dialogue opportunity became a four-hour testimony from dozens of parents about the heartbreaking harassment of students, to the point where several have left the district because the school board and the principal have not responded to complaints. This is followed by accusations of stonewalling, denial, accusations of telling actual lies by the principal and the school district. The testimonies were tearful and heartbreaking. Most of us are aware of Don Zaleggett's tearful testimony, where his son Don hid from him what he had to endure, and Donzel had to find out about it. No dad or mom should have to deal with this. The climax this week came from the reaction to one other piece of testimony from Amanda Flowers Peterson. She gave a tearful testimony about her decision to take her son out of the Chaska Public Schools. And then, for some reason, a group of up to 45 people put their name on a Facebook page demanding that she step down from her role as program director for Launch Ministry, one of the nonprofits that we support with dollars, with food, and support at city council meetings. For some reason, there are people who think that black people in nonprofits cannot be American citizens, that they cannot testify about incompetence in the school district. They cannot testify to the abuse and maltreatment of their kids. This is worse than ridiculous. Amanda is a powerful presence, a well-trained in executive skills, and very talented in making her case. People seemed threatened by the facts that she presented and the skills that she had used. Why? Because she's an African American. You need to know that I have immediately gone on record with a statement of support for Amanda and the executive director at Launch, Corey Magstead, with a statement giving them 100% a vote of confidence from this congregation. Amanda is not just speaking up about the experience of her kid. She has been racially assaulted on the job at Launch, their office downtown, a drop-in center, where the partner of a client she is working with began to call her the N-word, began to make the threatening sounds, and moving toward her with clenched fists. Amanda has de-escalation training, the kind the cops should be getting, and she just told the guy he had to leave. She did not engage with him or rebut him. She just said, "No, you have to leave now." And she got him out. The police department was very slow to recognize that a crime had been committed, racial assault, and after about 10 days, has finally acknowledged it and assigned an investigator to the case. The fact that she has been threatened at work and that her job was threatened by about 45 people who don't know what she does means that this perfectly altruistic, dedicated program director is being attacked by the people of Chaska. This is an eye-opener to many. But as was stated, after the massacre of 9 black people in a church in South Carolina, quote, "Racism is as American as apple pie. I don't understand why anybody is surprised by this. I understand it because I taught the civil rights movement for 11 years at Augsburg, and most of those young, bright-eyed, talented college students had only a glancing connection to anything more than the I Have a Dream speech. Occasionally, someone would talk about how their school studied it, but it was rare. And I have even heard of white people saying things like, 'Oh, when are you going to get over that black thing?' Saying it to a black person. We are hosting Launch Ministry for a Tuesday dialogue that has been long in the books for June 11th, which is about 2 weeks and 2 days away. We will do it as an act of support and also public education about homelessness in Chaska. There has been proposed a 16-bed facility, and there are 67 homeless young people who qualify for it. It's the tip of the iceberg. The mayor voted against it, even though at least 51 young people still living in tents by the river, in cars, or their buddy's couch, or in danger of being taken in by someone who will traffic them. The rest of the city council voted to go in favor of it, which is good. And this has nothing to do with the hundreds of families in Carver County that need housing that we've experienced through Families Moving Forward. The Roundtable Talkback, our education hour, has been digging into Minnesota racism for several weeks now. And today we learned from Jamila Anderson about what direction we need to go. It's a start. We can start by education. There is no silver bullet for this. There is no switch we can just flip and bring peace to Chaska. As Americans, we have grown up with the idea that we can fix things. All we need is a bigger hammer. But that ain't necessarily so. What it takes is patience and diligence without knowing about any sort of end date or result. It takes education of ourselves and sharing what we learn, but at the same time knowing that many people resist learning. They resist taking in facts that do not agree with what they already know, what they were brought up to believe. We have a couple more things to touch on here. Just know that as your teaching elder, I will be speaking in favor of racial justice in the school systems of Chaska, and that includes advocating for any mom or dad like Amanda who needs to speak up, whose testimony we need to hear. and who is being shut down as a woman and as a person of color. And I would be happy to meet with anyone you know, who wants to talk this through. Invite them over to have a cup of coffee with me. I want to return briefly to the text from the Bible that we read today to make a couple small points. Paul goes to Macedonia in response to a dream he had, gathered at a place on the river, a sacred place in ancient times, as a place of prayer in the presence of living, flowing water, just as the Dakota see the convergence of the Minnesota and the Mississippi as a sacred place. There, Paul meets a wealthy woman, Lydia. Although they meet in Philippi, Lydia is from Thyatira. Since she's living in Philippi, it seems that Lydia is away from home, a place with which she is still affiliated. Perhaps this made her particularly attuned to the needs of this group of men traveling, declaring the word of the Lord. Lydia is described by the work she does. She's a dealer in purple cloth. That's known as one of the most expensive commodities you can deal with. Laws regulate who can even own it, as it is reserved as a color of royalty. As a businesswoman, she is both able and willing to support the ministry of Jesus Christ by providing shelter to these ministers. She welcomes strangers in a place where she was once a stranger. Clearly, the growth of this church is a team effort, an effort that requires the extension of hospitality and generosity. It is important to remember that this hospitality and generosity may be found in unexpected places. Coming from those who we do not anticipate will extend it. Paul set sail looking for a man to share the good news with in Macedonia. Instead, he encounters a group of women. Lydia's hospitality is extended, not as a mom trapped in the kitchen, but as a highly successful merchant in a rare commodity on the level of being a jeweler or a dealer in gold and silver. She has a house and a staff, no mention of a husband, but there is a household. She has the humility to submit herself to the judgment of Paul and asks if this is an honor she is worthy of. And she takes them into a household large enough to lodge them and feed them. A successful, powerful woman. An unforeseen solution to the problem of sustenance on the road. The story from the Gospel of John should ring a bell. It does for me. The healing pool is also known as Bethesda, a place where the tradition is that an angelic force stirs the water up, and whomever gets in first is healed of whatever they got. Yet this poor guy has been lying there for 38 years, prevented from getting in because no one helps anyone else get in. Jesus says, "Do you want to be made well?" And this guy has no idea what this stranger is saying. He is, I'm imagining, pointing out that he has wanted to be made well for 38 years, you idiot, and no one will help me. Jesus takes another path, an unforeseen solution. Pick up your mat and walk.